Well, now that all my woodworking books are in here, what am I going to read in the bathroom?
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So on today's episode, we are building this small pine cabinet that we have here. And this entire project was built with materials that I picked up at my local home center. The wood itself comes from, have you ever seen those handy panels? They tend to be over near where you can pick up the one by material. They can be from about 11 and a quarter inches, maybe a little bit narrower, up to just a little bit wider, maybe close to 2 feet. And they come in all sorts of different lengths from about 2 feet up to maybe even potentially 8 feet in length. And that's what I ended up picking up, and that's what we're going to be using in here. In fact, you can kind of see this picture right here that we have. This was the panel we picked up. It was a 4 foot long one. I picked up about three of them to do this, but all the hardware, the hinges that we're going to be putting in here, these concealed hinges, everything came from the home center. So we're going to go ahead and get into the construction in just a little bit, but this is a really great project in the sense that it can be accomplished in about a day or so. And that includes doing some stuff with hand tools if you wanted to go that route. And we'll see some more about that when we get into the raised panel here on the front door. I will say before we really get deep into this, there are some concerns that I had with using the handi panels, and unfortunately they did come to light, and I'll discuss it in the building process itself. But right off the bat, one of my biggest concerns is just simply the thickness of the board. This one that we're working with, again, it's about 11 and a quarter inches in width, and it was 4 feet in length, but the thickness was about 5/8 of an inch. And I'm confident the main reason for that is when you look at this, these must be kind of like cutoffs from when they were making larger either panels, or maybe when they were cutting the boards to more of the dimensional, pre-dimensioned lumber that you might be familiar with in that aisle. And in order to glue these all together and get them to a uniform length, I'm sure they had to take them down to that thinner size that we have here. Again, this is about 5/8. I know there are some that are just a little bit bigger, but I don't really remember, unless I just simply completely missed it, seeing any that were about 3/4 of an inch. So there are some limitations to what you can do with the thickness, and I actually ran into one, and I'll point that out to you again once we get going. So speaking of get going, let's jump into the first part, which is actually milling the materials that we're going to be using in here, starting, of course, with the sides and the top and bottom for the cabinet. And we just did that over at the table saw. And again, since the panels were all uniform width, it was just a matter of cross-cutting them to length. So you can see that we went ahead and we got the sides taken care of, we got the top and bottom. And then once I had everything cut to what I thought was the proper length, I started to get ready to do assembling, or to get ready for the next part, which is creating these blind rabbets. But I noticed that there was a little problem with the sides, and it turned out that one of those three panels, and of course it had to be one of them that I chose to use for the side, rather than being 11 and a quarters of an inch, it actually kind of narrowed down more to like about 11 inches in total width. So that meant that I had to come back in and redimension all of the components for the top and the bottom and the sides, which is not really that big of a deal. It's just taking a quarter of an inch off, and it didn't affect anything else that I was doing with the rest of the project. So we went ahead, took care of that real quickly, which was just simply a rip cut. And now it was time to move on to creating the joint that I really like using now for any cabinet work, and that's the blind rabbet joint that we have right here putting together our corners. So without a doubt, one of my favorite joints for cabinet construction is the blind rabbet here. And we've used it a couple of times now in other projects. But the main reason for this, if I haven't emphasized it, is the fact that while it is a compound joint, we have a groove, we have a tongue, we have a rabbet, while there's several different components in here, it's actually very easy to make. And we can use a wide assortment of tools. We're going to end up using a table saw, and we'll get to that in just a second here. But it's really, really simple to put together. And because it is a compound joint, we also have a lot of surface space in here that's going to give us plenty of surface space to apply the glue, which means we're going to have a stronger glue joint. Another reason why I really like this, maybe this is the big one, is that regardless of whether I'm gluing it up or I'm just simply doing a dry run, when I've got these joints fitting the right way, which again are super simple to put together, it squares itself up immediately, which means that it's less fuss that I have to kind of concern myself with to get a good fit and to make sure that it's nice and square. It does all the work for me. In fact, I could easily put the glue in here, start putting the components together, walk over, grab some clamps, and then come back and then start tightening everything together. And really the only thing the clamps are doing is just kind of holding everything in place to let the glue set up. If you've done this the right way, you barely need any clamp pressure. You more or less just need clamp pressure enough to keep it together in case it swells and kind of pushes itself apart, which I don't know why that's going to happen, but you never know. So anyways, though, let's go ahead and get into the actual construction again. In this case, just like we've done in the past, we're going to do this at the table saw. We went ahead and loaded up a stacked dado head cutter. You could easily do this with a router. You could even potentially do this with just some hand planes or maybe even some saws and a chisel or something. But again, we're going to do it with the stacked dado. And the first thing we're going to do is here at the bottom, we're going to create that groove. Now, as you can see in this footage, what I ended up doing to set up the distance for where this one shoulder of the groove is going to be, I ended up using the full thickness of the bottom to set up that distance. Now, it didn't dawn on me until after I went ahead and cut this that I didn't want it that thickness. I actually wanted it a little bit narrower, but this worked out to my benefit because of the fact that here on the bottom, obviously there's going to potentially be a lot of weight here. Who knows? Maybe I might not use this for bookshelves anymore. I might have tools or something in here. So the fact that I've got just a little bit more material in here between where that groove is and the bottom tells me that it's just going to be that much stronger. It's just that much heftier down here. So the universe actually did me a favor. So what I did is once I went ahead and completed that cut on both sides, I then said, well, you know what? Thanks a lot, universe, but I want this to be much more flush at the very top. And as you can see it at the top, it is flush. And in order to do that, I knew that this rabbet eventually on the top, would be 3/8 of an inch up, and it's a 1/4 inch tongue. So I grabbed a 3/8 inch setup block and went ahead and I moved my rip fence over so that there was 3/8 of an inch difference between the final edge of the dado, the right edge of the dado blade and the fence. Once I had that, I went ahead and then completed that cut that worked out for the top groove that we have there. So as you can see, that was really, really simple. This groove, just for the dimension, is 1/4 inch wide by 1/4 inch deep. So once we had that, it's now time to then turn our attention to creating the rabbets for the top and the bottom. So the setup is pretty much the same for the top and bottom, except again, I mentioned this earlier, I want this rabbet to be 3/8 of an inch up from the very bottom so that it would give me a 1/4 inch tongue. And so again, I just turned to a setup block that I had to help me raise the actual blade to that height. Once I had that raised, I then put a sacrificial fence on my rip fence because I want to butt it all the way over to the very edge of the boards at each end that's going to fit into this groove. And once I had that, I just went ahead and simply ran them through, trying to make sure I push down as much as possible so that the board doesn't kind of raise up a little bit as I'm cutting over the dado, so it will be uniform straight across. And then once we had that taken care of, we went ahead to do a dry run, and I noticed that it was kind of not fitting at one end or the other. So that told me that even though I pressed down with the micro jig grippers, it actually, apparently in that board, there was some variation in the thickness. So that was really easy to fix. I just simply grabbed my shoulder plane and concentrated at those ends and did a couple of quick passes on each end where I needed to, and then would just double check that fit until I got a really nice snug fit. And by snug, I mean I can press it in with my hands. I got to kind of push a little bit. I don't want to have to whack at it because I don't want to break it. But it didn't take very long at all to get that in there. One more thing I did, again, to help kind of finesse these joints a little bit to make sure that everything fit together nice and snug and square and all the way around, is I noticed with the grooves that, you know what, there was a couple of spots where it just seemed to have a little bit of a gap here where the rabbet met up. So I grabbed a small router plane came in and cleaned those out. Actually, this footage makes it look like there was a lot of material being removed, but it was just because I didn't clamp anything down, so I had to work a little bit harder. But we ended up removing that, and we got probably some of the best fits that I've ever had on a blind rabbet joint. So once I had all of that taken care of and I got everything fitting the right way, I wanted to go ahead and install a back, or at least get ready to install the back. And the way to do this was to actually cut some rabbets on the back of the top, bottom, and of course the sides. So for whatever reason, I went ahead and I took off my stack dado and I put on my single blade. And that's no problem at all, because with the rabbet, it's a matter of just making a couple of simple passes on the single blade. So I set up a feather board to help keep everything snug against the fence, as you can see here. I know some of you would be saying that, well, it's really stupid I didn't install a tall sacrificial fence. And while that would have helped, that feather board kept it really, really snug and helped me keep an idea of where to keep my hands out of. So I went ahead and ran the board over on one edge at a height of about a quarter of an inch. Once I completed that on all four pieces, I then moved that feather board out of the way, made a slight adjustment so that the next thing I was going to do was put the board face down and then cut out the remainder of what would be the rabbet for the back. And this is one of those, if you notice here, you can see the piece shooting out. So you kind of want to step aside a little bit and make sure that you've got some sort of like the gripper or something on there to help hold it down and keep your hands safely out of the way. And more importantly, keep your waist area out of the way as that piece shoots out of the back. But that's all there was, just a couple of quick passes with a single blade to create the rabbets that we needed for the back here. There's one more thing I need to point out about cutting the rabbets for the top and bottom for the back to fit into, and that was they were on the opposite side of where the rabbets for the blind rabbet is. And when I was working with this, what I really should have done, and I highly recommend this, is make sure you mark the side that they're going to appear on, because they're always on the opposite side of. And I had to like double, triple, even quadruple check myself to make sure I got them on the right ones. So that's probably a really good tip to think about if you're going to do something very similar. So originally I was planning on having more than one shelf in here because, again, I wasn't certain what I was going to put in here, but you know, obviously the books have taken priority. So who knows, maybe I will come back in and add another shelf. But in order to do that, I have some nice adjustability in here in the sense that I've got these five holes, and it would be really easy with the jig I'm about to show you to create more holes if necessary. Again, if I do decide to put more storage items in here instead. But to do this, perhaps one of the most important things anytime you have adjustable shelves is to make sure that not only are the holes parallel with each other on the same side, but they're also parallel with each other on adjacent sides. And again, using this jig that I have, which is the Milescraft cabinet mate, which I have to tell you, of all the jigs I've used for adjustable holes, this one is probably one of the easiest and surprisingly the most accurate. I hope that doesn't sound too bad, but it's definitely one that I would highly recommend. So I start out by drawing a center line to help line up the jig. And additionally, I actually add a scrap board to help ensure that both sides of the same face are lined up with each other. Then it's a matter of just simply starting to drill a series of five holes on one side. Then I'm going to flip the jig over, which has these symmetrical holes up and down its body, and then I'm going to go ahead and drill on the opposite side. And the nice thing is it has this little storage compartment on it, which I just bump that right up against the edge, and that's what helps me to give perfect alignment on both sides of the sides. Now, in order to line them up with the adjacent side, I just simply put them side by side, and because I have that center line, I just go ahead and transfer it to the other board. And then I repeat that whole entire drilling process by setting up that little jig and just going to town with it. And it's a matter of just a few minutes before I have all of the holes that I need for the whole cabinet. So anytime that I've installed these concealed hinges or Euro hinges or adjustable hinges or whatever name you use to describe these, one of the things that I need to do is always create a story stick to figure out exactly where it is that I need to lay out for the screws themselves. And it's really simple to do that. But one nice thing with this cabinet mate jig that I was using to drill the holes is it's actually laid out to help you perfectly position each one of these concealed hinges. So it's a matter of coming in, putting it into the position that you want to put the actual hinge itself, and then using a self-centering drill bit that's included with the cabinet mate jig. You just simply puncture a little hole, which leaves a little dimple here on the side, and that tells you exactly where you need to come in and either pre-drill or just simply drive the screws so that the bodies are in position. Made it really super quick and simple, and again, just it was probably one of the easiest layouts I've ever done. Once I had that done, I needed to figure out where it is that I'm gonna drill for the cup here for the rest of the body of the hinge. And again, I used the cabinet mate jig to help me lay that out. Now, unfortunately, that one I still had to do a little bit of math in here, but where it is centered off of the edge, the jig does a really great job. They got a few different holes based on the size of the hinge you're using. And once I had that taken care of, figured out where the hole is, I then took it over my drill press, because why not? It's going to give me really accurate holes without any issue at all, and it supports it really nicely. You can do this with a hand drill, but we drilled for those holes and got them in place, and as you can see here, it was just a matter of coming up with an adjustable square, or with this fixed square that I have, and making sure that the cups get put in nice and square, and that's how we installed the hardware for the door itself. So at this point, we're almost done with the construction of the small pine cabinet. We just need to glue it together and then also to attach the door. So let's just talk real quickly about gluing it up. Again, the beauty of this blind rabbet joint in here is that it's self-squaring. So we just simply apply some glue into the grooves and making sure that we get that glue on the shoulders of the groove to really help make sure that we get a nice strong glue joint. And then once we have that taken care of at one end, we'll do it at the other. We'll then put in our top and bottom, get those in position. Don't worry too much about the glue squeeze out at this point. We'll then apply the glue on the tongues themselves and then a little bit in the actual groove of the other side. And then we'll bring it all together and we'll apply some clamps. I like to use the band clamps with this, which really helps to make sure that everything stays nice and square, even though it was already, because again, why? That's right, because of the actual blind rabbet itself. And then we'll go ahead and set the box aside to dry, and then we'll come back in later on to start finishing assembling it. For now, let's go ahead and talk about how we did this raised panel on the door. And this was a lot easier than you might actually think. There's several different ways we could do this. We could do it at the table saw by tilting our blade, or we could do it potentially with a chamfering bit with our router. But instead, what I decided to do was, I've got this really great skew rabbeting plane that I almost never use. And so I said, you know what, this would be one of those neat experiments to see, can I freehand this and get this angle uniformly around here? So that's exactly what we're going to do. So let's go ahead and take a quick look at that footage. Now, in order to make sure that these are at least as close to uniform all the way around, I want to establish two lines. The first line, and you can see we're using our marking gauge, was to come through here on the edges and create how deep we want the chamfer to actually go. So again, we went through on all the edges all the way around and created the same exact reference line. And then we went ahead and put the board down and we created a little bit longer, a little bit wider line here for the face that's going to define where this raised panel is. Once we have that all taken care of, and there's another reason why we want to do that, especially here on the end grain, it helps to kind of cut that so that our fibers, even though we did get some tear out in here, and again, I'm not too worried about it because this is a very utilitarian cabinet, it will really help to minimize some of that tear out that we're going to get there. So once we had those lines already drawn out, we went ahead, grabbed our skew plane, and we're just simply going to work to those two lines since we're freehanding this chamfer. So whenever we're using something like a rabbet plane, be it skew rabbet plane or just simply square rabbet plane, we start at what essentially would be the end and we work our way backwards. So that's exactly what we're going to do. And what I like to do is I will just pick one line, usually on the edge, and I will work that edge down until I get as close to that line as possible, working all the way back. Once that's taken care of, I'll then start to work myself towards that other line, And because we have that fence on the rabbet plane, it minimizes us going too far into this. And so you can see that we start working our way down. And in fact, actually, we end up kind of going past a little bit because that skew sticks out just a little bit more. But regardless, it's always going to be uniform because we're not going to play around with that fence. So as you can see, after several passes, we got down to what we want. And that's how we got this first face taken care of. There is a little bit of tear out up in some of this area right here, but again, I'm not too worried about it. And I could probably just come back in with some sandpaper and take care of it. Once we had both long ends, long grain ends taken care of, that's when I start to work on the end grains here, and that will help to minimize tear out. So we just simply put the board on its side, and then we start working this direction, doing the same exact thing. Work to one line, work at the end, work our way back, and then once we more or less get that established, we'll then start working to establishing that other line. And in no time at all, we have this nice raised panel. One thing I did notice, and perhaps you may even notice this, not only with, say, a hand plane, but I've noticed it with a router bit. If I was not putting enough pressure in one place, we'll actually see that these diagonal lines that help to define the corners will be off a little bit. They'll be in one direction that's not towards the corner. And typically that just means that you need to come back in and refine that a little bit. In my scenario, it was one of these long ends was not as deep. In fact, when I looked at the lines that I had scribed on the side, I in fact had not reached that line. So anyways, that takes care of all of that, and we get this beautiful raised panel that we have right here. So in the beginning, I had mentioned that there were a couple of issues with the thinness of this board, and this is one of them that I ran into. While doing the chamfer on this edge, I obviously blew right through to the hardware. But again, since this is such a utilitarian piece, I'm really not that worried about it. So at this point, we're almost completely finished building this little small pine cabinet. The only thing I needed to do was to drop the back in. In this case, I'm just using a 1/4-inch piece of plywood for the back. And as you can see, just drop it right into position. This is gonna help to maintain any squareness in case for whatever reason it is off a little bit. But because of that blind rabbet joint, I'm not too worried about it. And to get that in position, I just simply took some scrap nails that I had laying around, I'm not even sure where these came from, and toe-nailed those into position to make it really, really strong so it's not just going to simply pull away. In the future, if I were to build another one of these, which I just might do because I really like the size of this and some versatility with it, I might end up using maybe something a little bit thicker, either some scrap material from the actual build itself or maybe even some half-inch plywood just to give it a little bit more strength and a little bit more peace of mind for when I'm attaching it to the wall. But in this case, and I'm not really yanking on this, it's more or less for show, it's really, really, really rigid and quite in place. I'm pretty happy with it. But that's really all there is to building this beautiful piece. And again, it's very utilitarian, so there's plenty of little on it. If I was building this for somebody else and they were going to purchase it and they wanted something a little bit more showy, we definitely would come back in and take care of some of these little ouches here and there. But again, it's just, I think I paid a total of maybe $30, $40 for all the materials, including the actual hinges themselves. And that's pretty much all there is. In fact, I think I've got some stuff I can return to the hardware store, get some of my money back, so maybe it takes it down even less. If you have comments, questions, suggestions, you know how to get a hold of me. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Of course, you can leave a comment in the show notes at the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. And if you're watching this over at YouTube, you can leave some comments over there. I love hearing from all of you. Again, super simple project, something you can create all over the place, maybe add that extra shelf in there if you want to, or maybe a few extra shelves. Maybe you got really small things you want to put in there, who knows? But really simple to put together and a lot of fun. So until the next time, I will be talking to all of you then. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com.